morning. And welcome to worship on a lovely Sunday morning here on the 10th of July. Good to see everybody down here. I hope you're nice and comfortable down here. This is a more comfortable room to worship in, most definitely. Just a few announcements before we get going this morning. We have a couple things coming, not this month, but next month, that you can start planning and looking forward to now. On August 5th, you may have seen the notice go around with the announcements. Norval Presbyterian is having Reverend Dr. Brian
Fraser.
Yes, it jumped out of my head for a second. Reverend Dr. Brian Fraser is coming to talk about jazz meditation. Reverend Brian, I know Brian for 30 plus years. Kathy and I met him, probably General Assembly 93. And he has long had this fascination with jazz music and faith understanding. And so, I mean, I'm friends with him on Facebook. I get notices about events out in his church in Richmond all the time. Well, now Dr. Sarah Trapps is bringing him in for an evening of meditation with jazz. That's August 5th. That's the first Sunday of August. 3 weeks later, we have a very busy weekend. We have the Rock and Roll Car Show on August 26th, and we are going to be providing the barbecue for that. Again, that is the plan. If you're able to help out, please talk to Dennis. And you know, one way or another, we generally do a lot of business that night. It is a very busy night. It's great that the car show is back on, because it is just a fun night interacting with everybody who's looking at the cars.
You're flipping burgers, right?
I will flip burgers. I am flipping burgers again. And 2 days later, we are doing a meal at Evangel Hall. It's a Sunday evening supper. I've been in contact with the supper coordinator at Evangel Hall. They're doing 200 takeout meals every Sunday evening. It's all takeout now. They've only got, I think they said they had 22 in the dining room, but that's it, just because of restrictions and you know, these are not the safest people in the world. And so they'll only have 22 in their dining room, but they will hand out over 175 meals through the takeout window. We're gonna be doing meatloaf, mashed potatoes, and frozen veggies. So you don't have to worry about peeling carrots. We are gonna need some help with peeling potatoes. And it'd be really nice if we could farm out cooking of meatloaves, because we're gonna have like 8 to 10 pound meatloaves that we're gonna need to take down. We're probably looking at what, 80 to 90 pounds of meatloaf, possibly 100 after we put all the fillings in, to take down and cut up, because anything we don't serve, they will keep to serve other people. So that is something, if you've got oven space, that is something you're going to be asking for at the end of August. So please start thinking about it now if you're available. I don't think I have much else today. Our theme for the day is going to be the Good Samaritan as we get into that. But right now, let us thank God for the ability to be generous with our resources. Let us pray. God, our God, you are our soil, our food, our water, our sun, everything we need to grow. We offer our gifts to you, asking for your direction as we work each day so that your kingdom of light becomes more and more of a reality in this world. Amen. Friends, Jesus told us that the greatest commandments are to love the Lord our God with all our heart and soul and mind and strength, and to love our neighbors as ourselves. So let us worship God. Our opening hymn, for those with the hymn books, 642, O Master, Let Me Walk With Thee. Stand if you wish for this one. And let us pray. Holy God, you call us to live out your justice and righteousness. Help us to walk in your footsteps so that we never lose our way. Enable us to live and love in the way that you have taught us so that we can act in grace even with those whom we may consider our enemies. Forgive us when we do not defend the weak or the orphaned. Forgive us when we do not uphold the poor or the oppressed. Forgive us when we do not commit to efforts to rescue the weak and the needy, and instead, often unwittingly, deliver them into solitude and neglect. Rise up to judge us, O God, yet show us your merciful justice, taking away our guilt and fear. Straighten our path so that we can be guided as a mother or a father guides beloved children. We pray this in Jesus' most holy name, for it is through his name, his cross, and his empty tomb that we are saved. Friends, hear the good news. God's unconditional love does not seek appearances or conditions, but loves in such a way that we are restored to health and wholeness. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Our second song for this morning is, I'm going to call it a summer song, because it's one that is a little lighter and a little different. Can you put the third slide up, please, Charles? The one that has all three verses on it. That's the one.
709.
It's 709. In the choir, we rehearse this as a possible summer anthem, but what we're going to do is we're going to do it as a congregational song. So what we're going to do is we're going to split. Greta, you're on this side with Leslie. Follett, you're on that side. So we're going to put the line right up here. Steve, which side do you want to be on? That side or that side? You're going to be on this side? Okay. So shift over just a little. So this is a song that requires three parts. So we're going to sing it through all the way once. And then the choir is going to start, and when the choir finishes the first part, this side is going to start and sing it through. And when we get to the next part, this side will sing. And you're going to sing it through, we're going to sing it through twice. It's a round, and it's beautiful harmony over top. All you have to focus on is your part. You just sing your part. So Kathy means through, let's sing this through once. Just starting here. We're just going to stay here and we're just going to go through. We're just going to, hold time. Hold time. You're good. You're good.
Let's give it a try.
Responsive reading for today comes to us from Psalm 25, and you're reading the first 10 verses. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul.
Love, for they have been from of old.
not remember the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me for your goodness' sake, O Lord.
Good and upright is the Lord, therefore he instructs sinners in the way.
He leads the humble in what is right, and teaches the humble his way.
All the paths of the Lord are steadfast on up and faithfulness, for those who keep his covenant and his decrees.
Amen. So we've got, on one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. Teacher, he asked, what must I do to inherit eternal life? What is written in the law, he replied. How do you read it? He answered, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. You've answered correctly, Jesus replied. Do this, and you will live. But he wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? In reply, Jesus said, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So to a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said, and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have. Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? The expert in the law replied, the one who had mercy on him. Jesus told him, go and do likewise. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And it is our tradition here to, after we have heard the gospel, to take a moment to declare our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. And again, I invite you to stand and join together as we say, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he arose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness. song we're going to sing here just as our meditation is number 715 for those following in a hymn book. It's just a recitation of that commandment. Love the Lord your God. 715, love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all that you are. We're going to sing it through twice. Major key. Yep. So generally, I like my sermons in the summer to be a little lighter than normal. Something simple, generally something affirming. And if it's a challenge, try to make it easier to grasp. And what story from the Gospels could possibly be easier to grasp than that of the Good Samaritan? Everybody knows Jesus hailed the man who tried to stop, or who stopped rather, to help. And he hailed that man above the priest and the Levite who failed to do so. Man at the side of the road looked dead. Priest and the scribe didn't stop for good, solid, theological reasons. Because as they understood it, they stopped to help, and the man was dead, well, now they were considered ritually unclean until they could purify themselves. The understanding, according to the law of Moses, was, the law of Moses, all the debates and discussions that it centered around it, was that God would be more pleased with them for not stopping and remaining ritually clean than with them stopping in an attempt to render help to someone in trouble. Jesus challenged that understanding. He said that if one follows that most critical of the commandments, love God with all you have and are, and love your neighbor as yourself, then everyone in the world is your neighbor and should be treated accordingly. 1994, a prominent Presbyterian minister from New York City, Reverend Paul Lannan, died at the age of 87. After his death, his final book was published, entitled The Decalogue and the Human Future, The Meaning of the Commandments for Making and Keeping Life Human. In it, he tries to wrap his head around the meaning of the Good Samaritan by viewing it as a challenge to those who revered the law so highly. He said that for those who understand the law as gospel, the law as the good news that God gave to his people, then we present our obedience to the law as behavioral proof of our faith. Then, to justify ourselves, our increasingly refined understanding of the law's demands places human opinion and tradition on a par with revelation. The law becomes the means by which we've been given to arrive at the ends God must intend for us. The law marks the road, and there is no swerving from it. However, he said, when we seek to live as if the gospel were the law, we find ourselves setting off down a road where we don't necessarily know where we're going. We end up traveling by grace as radically vulnerable disciples sent out to respond to the human in the other along the way. This other brings out what Lehman called the obedience of faith in a world made and redeemed for being human in. We live in this world together. I occasionally find myself in a reflective mood as I drive down the road or down the highway. Where's everyone going? Why? What's drawing them there? What kind of mood are they traveling in? If I'm going down the 401, I'm usually going about 120. And if someone passes me at 140 or better, my traditional response has become, and Kathy, you should know this, what do I say? I hope you get there. That is what I say. When someone passes me, like, I hope you get there. And it is, and I don't call them agony. In my mind, be thinking they're an idiot or a fool for going that fast. But they probably have a reason for doing that. And I'm hoping and praying that they don't wreck themselves or someone else along the way. I don't know, maybe they've got a loved one who's dying and they're trying to rush to their side to say goodbye. Maybe they slept late and they have to get somewhere by a certain time or they'll lose their job. Maybe they're just a chronically impatient person. And every minute they spend in their car on the highway is a minute they're not doing something that is either more fun or has more meaning. Judging them does me no good. All I can do is pray that God goes with them and everyone else they pass by that day. And maybe if I say those words, my attitude towards them can move from something that is sarcastic to something just a little bit kinder. Because it's all about kindness, isn't it? When Jesus asked the lawyer which of the passers-by had proven to be more of a neighbor to the man in the ditch, many translations say the one to, it said here, the one to whom he showed mercy, but many translations say the one who showed him kindness. Kurt Vonnegut, who famously wrote the book Slaughterhouse-Five about his, it was a novelization of his experiences in the Second World War as a chaplain's assistant and prisoner of war. He was once asked by a young man from Pittsburgh, please tell me it will be okay. And Vonnegut replied, welcome to Earth, young man. It's hot in the summer and cold in the winter. It's round and wet and crowded. At the outside, Joe, you've got about 100 years here. There's only one rule that I know of. Dang it, Joe, you've got to be kind. All we can do is try to be kind to one another. In kindness is love. In kindness is grace. In kindness is found the ability to care for someone, no matter where they've come from, no matter what they're doing, no matter what they've done, no matter what they've not done. Kindness is in us to give to each other if we're in a good space, and especially if we're in a bad space. The decision to be kind belongs to each of us. Which of these was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? The one who showed him kindness. Now let's step back and look at that response for just a second from a different angle. I own a commentary set that has theologians of all stripes going through the lectionary readings for a given week and coming at them from four different angles. And I found it interesting that for the parable of the Good Samaritan, three of the four, and the fourth one was implied, talked about the fact that the lawyer could not even wrap his lips around saying the Samaritan had been the kind one. I've talked before and often about tribalism, about the separation of the world into we and they. And there doesn't seem to be any sharper division than between you and those just next to you. The one whose beliefs are just a little off from your own. Emo Phillips wrote a joke many years ago about, he didn't actually, but this is the joke. He says, I saw a man looking to jump off a bridge, and I ran up to him to try to stop him, and I said, you know, I told him that God loved him. Don't you believe in God? Man says yes, and then Emo parses out the understanding that they're both Christian, they're both Protestant, they're both Northern Conservative Baptist, they're both Northern Conservative Baptist Great Lakes region. But when the man says that he attends a church that abides by the teachings of the Evangelical Council of 1912 until 1879, Emo calls him a heretic and pushes him off. He told this joke as an example of the ludicrous length to which we will go to understand ourselves as somehow separate from others and justified in our separation. The lawyer, a scholar of the scriptures, would have known Leviticus 19, verse 17, says he should love his neighbor as himself. But the Jews have been working for 500 years to narrow the definition of that word neighbor to weed out and exclude everyone who didn't fit, including the Samaritans. And I'm not going to go into all the reasons why the Samaritans were different. You've heard that in 100 other sermons. Jesus would have us say, though, that it doesn't matter. Jesus would have us say to that other person, it doesn't matter how you believe in God or even if you believe in God. Our duty is to show loving kindness to the world, period. And if someone shows us kindness, we should receive it as such. We should understand that God's desire is for the world to come together in harmony rather than remain separated and hostile toward each other. If someone needs help and it is within your power to give it to them, help them. If you're in need and it is within someone else's power to help you, consider accepting it. And both of these need to be worked through without a care or concern for the differences between you. Reverend Dr. Douglas Hall, Professor Emeritus at McGill University, once wrote, "The great lesson of this parable for Christians today can be glimpsed only if the biblical ethic of kindness is put together, as it is in the parable, with the recognition that such behavior frequently emanates from unexpected sources, and in doing so, calls us up short. For the parable to achieve its full shock value in our context, one might try substituting the word Samaritan, which means little or nothing to our contemporaries, substitute instead words such as Muslim, Sikh, Buddhist, Jew, or even in some communities one can think of, Catholic. Until it is grasped that at the level of true morality, that is, where basic attitudes and acts are considered, where the fruits by which we are known, according to Matthew 7, verse 16, according to those become conspicuous, genuine goodness and moral authenticity cannot be restricted to any one people or creed and do not depend upon having learned the right theoretical answers. Without in the least denigrating theology or doctrine, Christians ought to recognize, as the Reformers did with their much underused concept of common grace, that there is in the human spirit a certain impulse to kindness that may or may not be the consequences of this or that creed, moral code, or faith tradition. What would it mean meaned interfaith dialogue, if such recognition were shared, at least as a beginning, by all participants? What if, in every interfaith encounter, our residual human capacity for compassion were transcended, or prodded rather, by a transcendent voice whispering in our would-be believers' ears, "For God's sake, Christian, be kind." Father Jim Wallace, in his comments on the parable and on the unlimited compassion and kindness Jesus calls us to show our neighbors, refers first to the question the lawyer asked, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" To which Jesus replies with the ancient commandments. The lawyer seems to view it as a goal, an ending point. Jesus, suggests Father Jim, viewed eternal life as something that starts here, now. Father Jim then spoke of Ahmad Khatib, an 11-year-old boy who had been living with his family in the Jenin refugee camp in the West Bank in 2005. When he was seen by an Israeli soldier, the soldier saw something in the boy's hands that he thought was a gun. It was, in fact, a toy gun. He raised his weapon and fired, and he struck the boy in the head. His body survived the trip to the hospital, but there was no brain function other than the reflexes of breathing and heartbeat, and that assisted by machines. 2 days later, his father made the decision to donate his organs, as many as could be given, to whoever needed them. To whoever needed them. Not Palestinian children, not Muslim children, whoever needed them. 6 children, mostly Israeli, benefited from Ahmad's death by receiving his heart, his lungs, his kidneys, and more. One recipient was a 2-month-old infant. Ahmed's mother said, "My son has died. Maybe he can give life to others." And Father Jim wrote, "These parents made their own journey into compassion, into the compassion of God, and they were living eternal life." And he wrote further, "The parable of the Good Samaritan is a story for travelers on the road, a scriptural GPS, routing us in the only direction God desires, the way of love and compassion for others. This is more than a parable about a helpful stranger. It is about the transforming power of God at work in those who travel the dangerous roads in our world, moving us into the fullness of life, eternal life, here and now." So I hope I've given you some new insights on this old parable. Simple fact is, as I've already said, we live in this world together. God created us to be with each other and to be kind to each other. Let's pray about this. Let's pray. God of grace and goodness, when we hear these old stories, it's so easy to hear them with our modern ears. To hear this one is a simple call to mindfulness rather than a challenge to the selfish nature that is within us all. We exist in tension, being kind and compassionate on one side, being selfish and greedy on the other. And stories like this challenge us to lay down the selfish and greedy part and be kinder and more compassionate. The one who told us this story touched unclean lepers and healed them, raised up broken women when no one else would engage them, treated everyone he met, friend or stranger, countryman or foreigner, as a child of God, and calls on those who would be his disciples to do the same. Help us to be as he was here, now, in our place, in our world. Give us vision, Lord, to see each other as such. Give us ears to not just hear, but to listen to the cries for help of those around us. Give us hands to reach out, arms to hold, feet to move us to where we need to be, and strong backs to help each other bear the load. Help us understand our differences and to embrace one another in our need for you. Spirit of strength and truth, hear us today as we pray for the many who are on our hearts. We pray for those who are struggling to find a way forward in life, held back as they may be by illness, injury, poverty, or personal history. May they lay everything into your hands and receive from you the blessings and encouragement to move forward, always and ever at your side. Hear us as we pray for the medical staffs at our hospitals and nursing homes, at clinics and offices around the world. Refresh their compassion and their strength as they tend to the physical needs of their patients. Be with psychologists and psychiatrists as they tend to mental distresses. Be with pastors and teachers and Bible study leaders as they tend to the spiritual lives of those around them. Indeed, give us full lives, whole lives, we pray. Most of all, hear us as we pray for those who are feeling wounded and discarded, left by the side of the road by some abuse that has been laid upon them by another. Send them their Samaritan who will bind their wounds, lead them to help, is mindful of their well-being. If it be us, gird us for what we will face. And again, we lay all these things in your hands, trusting in your Holy Spirit to be with us as we face them, endure them, survive them, in body, mind, or soul, as you will. And now, Lord, we bring together all of our prayers and present them using the words Jesus taught us as we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Before we sing our final hymn for today, just a reminder that as of the benediction of this service, I am officially on full holiday. I will be gone for the next 3 weeks. I will have my phone with me, but service is not always reliable. So please, if you have a pastoral emergency, contact your elder. If you call me, please be prepared to leave a message, and I will get back to you as soon as I can after that message. I hope and pray that there are no pastoral emergencies over the next 3 weeks. Next week and the final week of July, Craig is going to be leading the services. And in the middle week, we're going to have a special guest, Laura Lee Campbell. Laura Lee grew up in Georgetown, and she is now serving as a minister, or not as a minister, as the representative elder of St. Andrews Hillsburg. And she actually came to a preaching course that I put on just before COVID closed the world. And I promised her, I said, the next time I go on vacation, I'm going to call you. And she has agreed to come and lead the service on the 23rd, or the 24th rather. So I'm looking forward. We're home. We haven't left yet. So we may come and hear her and sit out there. But our final song for today is one we have sung it before, but it's just a lovely piece to close everything. Let it be said of us.
It's the photocopy.
It's the photocopy. It's the photocopy sheet. And please stand to sing.
Let it be said of us that the Lord was our master.
neighbors, through doing justice, through speaking out, and through defending those who are weak and oppressed. And may God fill us all with the knowledge of his will. May Jesus Christ, who has rescued us, give us constant faith to speak the true word of the gospel. And may the Holy Spirit guide us in wisdom and understanding so that the world can flower the love of God. Amen.